A global cyber attack has disrupted NHS hospitals and GP surgeries in England and Scotland, resulting in cancelled operations and IT shutdown.
It kind of replicates itself from one computer to the next, and there's really no stopping it. It spreads itself like a plague.
So who and what is behind the attack, and can they be stopped? Tonight, a former hacker, a former GCHQ boss, and the chair of the GP's Council are all here. What's it like for one of the rising young stars of the Labour Party who's not a Corbyn fan selling the manifesto on the doorstep?
I think it does make it easier when you have some clear lines in the sand between you and the other side. I think it will make it easier actually having the manifesto.
Missing in general election action, we go in search of one of the most senior figures in Theresa May's cabinet to try to find out if she's been sidelined. Where is Andrea Leadsom?
Andrea Leadsom, Secretary of State for what used to be called Argan Fish! Andrea Leadsom, are you here?
And Caitlin Jenner, who before she transitioned from Bruce was feted as one of the most famous athletes in the world, talks about her long and difficult journey to womanhood.
It takes a while, time, and I'm 2 years in, to kind of leave Bruce behind, because he's still in there, okay?
Good evening. As we go on air, the extent of the international ransomware cyber hack on 70 countries, which has struck NHS hospitals and GP surgeries in England and Scotland, is becoming clear. 25 NHS trusts in England and 9 commissioning groups and 5 NHS trusts in Scotland have all been affected. Several hospitals have announced that only patients requiring medical treatment, emergency medical treatment, should attend A&Es, and some surgery has been cancelled. Many healthcare trusts have switched off their IT systems, which control everything from X-ray imaging systems to pathology test results, phone and bleep systems, and patients' administrative information. Tonight, the Prime Minister said the government was not aware of any evidence that patient data had been compromised.
Well, we're aware that a number of NHS organisations have reported that they have suffered from a ransomware attack. This was not targeted at the NHS. It's an international attack and a number of countries and organisations have been affected. The National Cyber Security Centre is working closely with NHS Digital to ensure that they support the organisations concerned and that they protect patient safety.
Our technology editor David Grossman is with me now. He's been following the story this evening. Just how deep are the tentacles of this ransomware?
Well, what we know is this. It affects Windows operating systems by Microsoft. Now, over the Easter weekend, someone dumped on the internet, on an obscure website, tools to exploit a vulnerability in these Windows operating systems. Who was that person? Who developed those tools? We don't know. But I have to say, there are rumours swirling around the internet that those tools were developed by the American National Security Agency. Now, we know from WikiLeaks they do have that kind of capability, but we can't verify where these tools came from or who used them. What we do know is that somebody exploited the vulnerabilities that those tools exploited to attack lots of organisations, not specifically, they just spread this malware around the internet using ransomware. Now, Microsoft say that all that was necessary for anyone to protect themselves against this was to use free antivirus software and to make sure that their operating systems were updated regularly, because Microsoft issued patches. So the question is, why doesn't the NHS do that? Why was the NHS vulnerable? Well, as we found out today, it seems that the NHS is particularly vulnerable because they haven't been able to afford to update all their systems. So some of them are so elderly, they can't actually be patched.
Just as hospitals have had urgently to update their response to the threat of superbugs, so they're now having to consider their digital hygiene, how to stop machines getting infected and then spreading a virus to others in the network.
It kind of replicates itself from one computer to the next, and there's really no stopping it. It spreads itself like a plague.
The NHS, it seems, was not specifically targeted, but it has been particularly vulnerable.
In terms of the NHS, there have been individual malware attacks on individual trusts over the past 18 months, but this is the first time that we've had 21 trusts have been affected. So it's affecting multiple trusts at the same time, and that's the difference this time.
This is the screen that appeared in hospitals and GP surgeries, demanding a $300 ransom to unlock files and systems. It meant cancelled operations and treatments.
Cannula up. I daren't show you mine. I've been shaved down the front because they were going to open me up. My arms have been shaved, so I was all ready to go, nil by mouth, since this morning. And then at 1:30, the surgeon turned up and said, unfortunately, we've been hacked and there's nothing we can do. We can't operate on you today.
What will be particularly alarming to ministers and officials here at the Department of Health is how apparently simple this attack is. This doesn't seem to be the work of hacking geniuses. It's more the cyber equivalent of a street robbery. And yet, it's managed to paralyse a good chunk of the nation's healthcare system. Someone somewhere in the NHS system, it seems, opened an email attachment or clicked on a link which let the malware in. This threat, though, has been known about for at least 6 weeks, and security patches to protect against it have been issued. But it seems many NHS machines hadn't been updated and were vulnerable. Krishna Chintapalli is an NHS doctor who studied hospital IT systems. He wrote an article warning about the possibility of a major shutdown just 2 days ago, although he says he wasn't talking about the hospital where he works, which is unaffected by today's problems.
These operating systems tend to be quite old, so a study in January suggested that 90% of NHS trusts use Windows XP operating system. Now, this was an operating system that was released 15, 16 years ago by Microsoft, and it's not even being patched or fixed by Microsoft anymore, and they've advised people to upgrade. Problem is, it's not the same as a home user. In a healthcare organization, it becomes very tricky because you have a lot of proprietary software running on top of those. And that means, unfortunately, healthcare organizations may be some of the last to upgrade from old operating systems or old programs, and that increases the vulnerability. Hackers know this, and they're exploiting it.
The solution is simple, but for cash-strapped NHS trusts, very expensive.
Not using out-of-date software, not using, you know, systems that are just too old to handle, you know, constant updates, you know, have to be remedied. There's got to be something that's done. You know, if you constantly use old technology that's easily hacked or easily can be compromised, you can expect that to happen, and, you know, over and over again.
This attack doesn't seem to have resulted in any data loss, but the kind of personal information that hospitals hold is really valuable to criminals. You can, after all, change your credit card number or your bank details quite easily. You can't change your date of birth or your blood type.
First and foremost, we hold patient data, of course, and this data is sensitive. So this includes clinical information about patients, you know, national insurance numbers, date of birth, addresses. So all of this can be sold by hackers. And we don't know exactly, of course, but unreliable estimates suggest maybe about 10 times as much as credit card information.
In a statement, the NHS in England said that patients should continue to use GP and hospital services if they need them, but ask them to use them wisely while what they call this major incident is continuing.
David Grossman, well, Jake Davis is a reformed hacker who found global infamy in 2011 as Topiary, the face of the notorious LulzSec hacking group. He was convicted of hacking in 2013, now works as a security consultant. Professor Helen Stokes-Lampard is chair of the Royal College of GPs Council. And joining us from Bristol is Brian Lord, former GCHQ Deputy Director for Intelligence and Cyber Operations. Good evening to all of you. First of all, Professor Stokes, what is the impact on services and what will it be over the next few days?
Well, so far what we know is quite a lot of GP services and hospital services have just had to be shut down in terms of their IT systems. But for those patients who need urgent care, remember the doctors and nurses were trained to look after patients before we had computers. We can still talk to patients, examine patients and make decisions on the basis of what we see and feel, not just on what the computers tell us.
But when you listen to what David Grossman and indeed the doctor there was saying about the scope of this hack, you have very sensitive information on these computers. And a lot of these NHS computers are just out of time.
Well, that's right. They are out of time, but they've been a good servant so far. And these systems are backed up. So the system, the data we think is very safe. It's there. But what we have is an absence of data in the short term to help us with dealing with patients, putting them through the system. So appointment systems are messed up. And so it's going to be a little bit disrupted.
You heard David Grossman say that some of the NHS equipment is so elderly, it can't be patched.
Indeed.
So you're going to have new systems now.
We are. And indeed, ourselves and all the other colleges have been calling for serious infrastructure investment for a long time. Overdue.
Brian Lawler, from GCHQ's position, I take it everybody is trying all sorts of ways to try and fix this tonight. I mean, who's at work here?
Well, I think, first of all, what we're seeing here, there'll be two types of responses. I think, first of all, you have GCHQ and the National Crime Agency looking at the investigation of the crime itself. And then you'll have the National Cybersecurity Centre working with NHS Digital to work out how NHS Digital can resolve the issue. The issue about who's at work here, this is the next step up for international organised crime. International organised crime started with low-level theft, low-level use of ransomware. They've by and large contracted that out now, and they are moving now to a larger scale, far more sustained, far more coordinated effort, whether that's getting inside the infrastructure of banks or, as we see here, a very well-timed, very well-coordinated delivery of a simple tool, but delivered at mass scale into vulnerable areas.
But the vulnerable area, exactly, is the NHS. Now, it's not, as far as we know, in other areas. As you say, it's not in banks, it's not even in operating systems for the energy industry. It's just in the NHS.
Well, I think what we're seeing here with the NHS is the reasons that we've already seen. The NHS is particularly vulnerable because of the old nature of its IT systems, and also because it's very, very complex interconnectivity between surgeries, trusts, boards, and so on. So as a consequence, there is an awful lot of openings, I think, for delivery of this type of basic malware.
Thank you very much. Jake Davis, I mean, you have been a hacker in the past. What do you think is going on?
Well, I think the most terrifying thing about this is how simple it is. The sort of ransomware that was deployed, it might have been a sophisticated criminal organization, or it might have been just some kid that hit the go button and then a worm has just spread while they've gone to take a nap and they've woken up and gone, oh, I have 50,000 computers. Because, of course, it wasn't just the NHS that was hit. Yeah. I think the NHS was hit completely by accident. Telefonica in Spain was hit, the Russian Interior Ministry.
70 different countries.
Over 70
but the point
countries.
Is they're putting up this ransomware and it's pretty cheap, pay $300 and it gets scanned. Do people actually pay up?
Well, in this particular ransomware, there was a Bitcoin address to pay the Bitcoin to the cryptocurrency, the ransom. And we've seen quite a few ransoms being paid to it.
Right, so it is working.
Yeah, it does work, and it
how are they going to get
files.
Rid of it? People like you, who have been on the other side of the law, do you regret being on the other side of the law, by the way?
Yes, of course.
You do. People that you've been on the other side of the law who are incredibly well-connected, are you all working at the moment to try and sort this?
Yes, in this particular incident, I've been speaking with a bunch of security researchers, really talented people, and looking at why this exists, what exactly needs to be patched to fix it, and stopping it in the future.
And therefore, how long, in your view, will this infection go on?
Well, in order to fix it, you just need to update one thing. It's a very simple patch that was released by Microsoft 2 months ago. And the reason this works is because systems haven't patched it.
But isn't the problem here that this may be relatively simple and, as far as we know, reasonably benign. But isn't the problem that we see, as exactly Jake's saying, Brian, that actually one simple button pressed by an organisation that perhaps has really, really nefarious reasons for doing it could be very, very dangerous for the world?
I mean, yes, it can under certain circumstances. And I think one of the interesting things about what that's happened here is there's been a double whammy here. So first of all, you have the ability of ransomware to propagate itself within a system. But also, because of the nature of the NHS and probably within the NHS not a full understanding of exactly how they're configured, they have had to take down just about everything because of their dependence upon IT. And so it's the response to the ransomware as well as the ransomware infection which has almost brought a national service to its knees. And I think that is probably, it's possible to replicate that in other sectors.
Tell me, what's the chances of catching them, Brian Lord?
I think the chances of catching them are probably very slim in the short to medium term future.
Thank you all very much indeed.
Thank you.
This was the week when Labour's 45-page draft manifesto was leaked and Jeremy Corbyn was accused of taking the party back to the future, to the 1970s. The manifesto is now set in stone, though not formally published. So how is it playing on the doorsteps, particularly where the Labour candidate has been openly and repeatedly critical of Jeremy Corbyn? Emily spent the day in Birmingham Yardley constituency where, to say the least, Jess Phillips is a very outspoken candidate.
Look for the beating heart of Birmingham Yardley on a Friday evening, you'll end up here. and Muslim barbers, named after Italian mobsters, where they come in droves on payday. How often do you come here, Fahim?
Every week.
And what's your ritual?
Friday prayer and straight to the barbers for my weekly haircut, and then sometimes I go to dinner to Mohammed's house after.
The business is as old as the last parliament, set up 2 short years ago by brothers who tell me they work a 7-day week. They'll queue for up to an hour. They come for razor cuts, skin fades and eyebrow threading, which looks vastly more painful. They're local boys who work mostly in Birmingham's car industry. I want to know if next month's election is on their mind. Are you normally a voter?
Normally vote, yeah, normally Labour. But obviously things are changing now, so whatever suits my needs, that's what I've got to go with now. So.
What do you mean things are changing?
Well, the way life is, you know, like money-wise, you know, you're working and you got to look at your family and see what's best for them. So whatever the big deals, best deals come for your family.
So it, might it be Conservative this time around?
It could well be, yeah. It could well be.
How do you make your choice?
I tend to go with the majority. So my peers, my close relations, friends, family, etc. I do tend to go along with that at times. But
do you get the sense that a lot of people are voting this time, or are they not very interested? Or
I don't think a lot of the youth that is interested, yeah.
Perhaps he's right. This time it feels like more of the election enthusiasm on the doorstep comes from its canine community. But this is a battleground seat, in more ways than one. A surprise gain for Labour in 2015 from the imploding Lib Dems, the two candidates face each other again in a fight both visceral and personal.
This bit is one of the more affluent bits of my constituency.
We've come to find Jess Phillips, a self-styled everywoman, the MP before dissolution.
Charity workers, that sort of thing. Did you vote Labour in the last general election? Don't worry, I won't be offended if you didn't vote for me. I'll have a word with Jane, but no.
She'll be coming around to sort me out, I know.
Will you be getting out to vote on June the 8th?
Yeah, yes, yes.
And how will you be voting? Which party will you vote for?
I've generally always voted for the Labour Party.
She's no fan of her leader, Jeremy Corbyn, but I'm wondering if Labour's leaked manifesto has given her ammunition on the campaign now.
I think it does make it easier when you have some clear lines in the sand between you and the other side. I think it will make it easier, actually, having the manifesto.
There is no doubt about it that people feel that whilst they might have voted Labour in the past, they're not sure about Corbyn. It does come up.
And why are they not sure? Because, as you said, there's a shopping list now of policies that are pretty attractive to a lot of people.
Yeah. Actually, I think that they probably will be a bit surer after the manifesto if it reaches them. I think that they will. Because actually what is in the manifesto, aside from some of the stuff around nationalising things, it really is the kind of thing that gets raised with us on the doorstep.
How do you make sense, Jess, then, and we're trying to make sense of this, that when Jeremy Corbyn goes out into the country, he has these amazing crowds, there's noise, there's excitement and there's enthusiasm, and the polls don't seem to tally?
I think it's a potentially dangerous thing for him, because if you have a feedback loop that is always kind to you, then you might not be getting the real sense of the picture. Theresa May is guilty of this as well at the moment. I think she's closing herself off and only allowing, you know, the faithful to speak to her. This isn't Jeremy Corbyn's problem alone.
Her Lib Dem opponent in this seat, the MP before her, is John Hemming. The Lib Dems are really hoping for a resurgence this time round. Are you feeling that resurgence?
I wouldn't say it's going massively well, but in Yardley it's going well. So I don't know about other places, because it's difficult to tell, and when I'm talking to people on the doorstep, it's very much the local story.
The Conservative Party candidate is duly elected.
And what was once a two-horse race has just been re-energised by a critical Tory win.
Last week I was elected across all of the West Midlands as mayor, standing as a Conservative candidate, and I think something very significant happened last week, because people said, let's think about whether our traditional loyalty to the Labour Party really has delivered for us.
A month from today, the political map will be redrawn. The bubble may talk of landslides and resurrection, crushing defeat or party splits, but much of the country will simply carry on and do what they do on any other Friday night.
That was Emily. Here's a list of the candidates who are running for the election in the Birmingham Yardley constituency. Well, the Labour Party manifesto leak meant that this week wasn't quite what had been planned for the election campaign. 4 weeks tonight, we'll be digesting the results, so let's touch in with our regular panel of experts and assess how things are going. I'm joined by Camilla Cavendish, who was head of policy at Number 10 under David Cameron, and the journalist and Labour activist Paul Mason. Good evening to both of you. Camilla, listening to Jess Phillips there, that's quite an interesting tactic that however and whatever way this manifesto draft was leaked, it gave candidates something to speak about that wasn't Corbyn.
Well, I think that's probably right. And she said, you know, there's a big dividing line between the parties. Well, boy, there is a big dividing line now. I mean, the question is, will the country go for a prospectus that is, you know, I don't know what Paul's going to say about it, but I mean, it's a throwback in many ways. It's a throwback to the 70s. It's got huge uncosted promises.
Yes.
I don't think the country will go for that.
But in fact, Theresa May, rather than talking about the manifesto, which she certainly won't do, she's sticking to Corbyn, and she's saying today in the north of England, you know, that Corbyn has absolutely abandoned proud, patriotic, working-class voters. She doesn't want any truck with talking about manifesto.
I think let's talk about the manifesto first, though, because for us it was an absolute, I mean, fortuitous thing in a way, because it created drama in the election,
exactly,
as well as content, which there hasn't been much of. And it draws a clear line. I mean, when people say it's throwback to the 1970s, remember, so many voters are, you know, over my age, mid-50s and above 60s and 70s. Many of them would look at the 60s and 70s as the very good period.
Yeah, but you've got to get the younger voters who are simply not voting.
Well, when the younger voters hear, I couldn't wait to get out and say, you know, we will give you a free university education like I had in the 70s that enabled my generation to have such great social mobility. I think they understand that.
But who's going to pay for it?
Yeah, exactly. Who's going to pay for it?
That's to come, isn't it? I wouldn't worry about the uncosted nature of it. I know the team who are working on the costings. They have been over it several times. The attack line that I think is sensible is, what is the macroeconomic impact of taking so much tax out? The tax will be easily collected.
Just on that question of the leak, because it's interesting, because it added drama. Was it the moderates leaking trying to change it, or was it the left leaking it, going, this is better than having Corbyn sitting there next week and delivering it?
When I first heard of it, I did suspect it was the left, but I'm pretty confident now that it was Jeremy Corbyn's enemies.
So, some popular measures, you know, obviously motherhood and apple pie, let's have, you know, £6 billion a year for education, £6 billion a year for the NHS. By the end of the parliament, let's have no tuition fees and so forth.
Yeah, yeah.
But some things did strike a chord, even with you.
Oh, I think there are. I mean, I think this is the tragedy of these things, is there are usually some quite interesting things in any manifesto. There are a couple of things in the Labour manifesto which actually are quite sensible. I mean, abolishing the idea of quarterly returns for small business. I mean, hooray. You know, actually nationalising the railways, a huge number of people who are trying to get in on Southern Rail, who have not been able to get to work for 2 months, know there is something wrong with the railway.
In London, but actually up north it's a bit better.
The East Coast Main Line actually was nationalised. It's worked really well. In fact, Network Rail is nationalised, so it's a slightly odd, but you can do something with the franchise. So it's not entirely crazy. It's just that the totality of it doesn't add up.
But balancing out what Theresa May said at the beginning of the week, that she was actually going to stick to the Conservative view of limited immigration to tens of thousands, whereas Jeremy Corbyn said very little at all about immigration. Was she right, do you think, to announce that immigration, which they've never managed to do?
It didn't surprise me at all that she has stuck to that. I think she believes that you must have a stretch target. And I think she also believes that to move away from that... Well, that is a very good question, but to move away from that at a time when immigration is such a huge issue for the country would be a mistake. However, she did keep the students in the target, which is going to make it much, much harder.
But on the other hand, Jeremy Corbyn says nothing much about immigration, which actually is going to go down very badly with the UKIP voters you want to get.
Well, Labour's main pitch in this election is not to UKIP
voters. Okay, some Labour voters voted UKIP last time.
And even then, Labour's main pitch, I think, will be to the centre in politics, that it wants to convince that it has a humane and stable and thought-through solution to what kind of country this country becomes after Brexit. Now, such people work for companies. Those companies are saying to them, and they can hear it, look, guys, there won't be any less migrants after Brexit because we cannot function without it. So I think Theresa May keeping the tens of thousands target is an interesting thing, because you could have slipped the students out of it, making it more achievable, but she missed it every other time. So why should she hit it?
But surely Jeremy Corbyn's got to say something about immigration, because, you know, in those 45 pages, there was virtually nothing there.
Well, look, the point about what there is there is an offer to people to say, we can solve a lot of what your a lot of what your problems seem to be by very radical measures which redistribute wealth and empower you at work. Because the interesting thing is, when you talk to working class people about migrants and immigration, you find very, very few who claim to dislike the migrants themselves. And therefore, it's a different kind of xenophobia and nationalism that we're dealing with. And I think you can deal with it by radical economic offers to people who believe they've been given nothing,
Paul,
by the present system.
But Paul, it's work that's missing from the Labour manifesto. Where are the jobs? How are we going to create the jobs? What
We've
are the
got
jobs
plenty
in the future?
Of jobs. It's just not
What's
of them
the prospectus
wages?
For skills? Where's the technical
well,
education?
I think that's there.
Those are the big questions that people want answers.
There's a £10 billion budget on skills.
Luckily, we've got 4 more weeks to answer some of these questions.
Yes.
Thank you very much indeed. In a general election campaign, it's normal for the political parties to put out their big guns around the country. And there are no bigger guns for the Conservatives than the Prime Minister and her cabinet. But a significant number of these souls have all been silent, causing some to wonder whether this campaign is one of the most carefully controlled we've ever seen. One of those who appears to have gone missing in action is Environment Secretary Andrea Leadsom. You might have expected to have seen her on national TV recently, especially as the Tories announced their anti-pollution strategy last week. But no, Andrea Leadsom seems to be the nowhere woman. John Sweeney went in search of her.
Where is Andrea Leadsom? There's an election on and senior Tories are in short supply, but one of our cabinet ministers is missing.
And the Conservative Energy Minister, Andrea Leadsom.
Less than a year ago, the Brexiteer wowed Wembley.
We should take back control and look after our own society.
Andrea was all over the airwaves, running but losing against Theresa May. Leadsom was catapulted into the cabinet, but once there, seems to have vanished. On big days for her environment department, like last week when it was in the firing line over diesel pollution, she was nowhere to be seen. The Tory machine told us the Prime Minister's former rival was not around. We contacted Andrea's agent repeatedly. No reply. So where is she now? This is no ordinary detective job. Conservative Central Office won't tell us where she is. So I tracked down the address of her local Conservative club by typing it into Google. Alas, she's not here. But then a breakthrough. One of my team of researchers rings me, and it's a hot lead. Andrea Leadsom has just tweeted, on the way to Cornwall to support some Tory MPs, lots of singing in the car. Our problem, we're in Northamptonshire. Off we go.
Cornwall's a long way. So why are we following Andrea Leadsom to the edge of the known universe? You could say we're just mucking about, and there is an element of truth in that. But also the other thing. This general election has the feel of the most over-controlled, stage-managed, and yes, boring election ever. And that can't be good for our democratic system.
In the morning, it begins to dawn on me just how difficult the case might be. She's in Cornwall, but I have no idea where.
Andrea! Andrea Leadsom! Andrea Leadsom, Secretary of State for what used to be called Ag and Fish! Andrea Leadsom, are you here?
To be frank with you, I don't think she's here. So we're trying to get in touch with a guy called Luke, who we think is Andrea Leadsom's agent. We found him several times, and he's never phoned us back. I'm not saying the hunt for Andrea is getting desperate, but the hunt for Andrea is getting desperate. But then, a breakthrough. So we've had a tip-off that Andrea Leadsom is in a farm, talking to farmers just up here on the road. It's private property, so we can't film on it, but I'm gonna get out the van and
and see if I can talk to her.
We've just missed her. The lady in the farmhouse said she's been and gone. She was talking at 1 o'clock. It's now 1:25, so we've only just missed her. The search for Andrea Leadsom continues.
You may know John Sweeney.
At Wits End, time for a Where's Andrea appeal on local radio. Where is Andrea Leadsom?
Well, if you have seen her, 01872222.
One listener rings in to tell us she's been spotted in Penzance. She's even tweeted a picture of herself campaigning by the sea. But is she still there? Look at the detail in the back of the picture. There's St. Michael's Mount. There's the red boat. It's exciting to think that Andrea Leadsom stood on this very spot. But the truth is, we've missed her. But then, just as we were about to leave, a surreal twist in the story.
Well, so she's said you...
So Andrea Leadsom is playing cat and mouse with us. I tweeted at her, where is Andrea Leadsom? And she has just tweeted a picture of some woods. So she's mucking about. We want to interview her. We want to ask questions. There's a general election. She's a cabinet minister. But for the moment, it could be any wood in the whole of the West Country. Was her tweet a sly wink from her that she's been told to stay stum? Hi mate, we're from BBC Newsnight. Have you seen Andrea Leadsom? She was in Penzance to talk to fishermen. Sadly, we couldn't find any who'd met her. We've grown used to the idea of message discipline since New Labour and its pager culture, but disappearing ministers, that seems like a whole new level of control freakery. And as for the missing woman herself, we tried our hardest, but Andrea Leadsom was, as the fishermen like to say, the one that got away.
Inspector Sweeney there, and we'll be dispatching him to hunt for missing politicians from other parties before the election. We did ask Tory Central Office if they'd told Leadsom and others not to speak to Newsnight during the campaign, but they didn't get back to us. Caitlyn Jenner was the archetypal American jock, one of the United States' most famous and revered athletes who, as Bruce Jenner, took Olympic gold in the decathlon in Montreal in 1976 and broke the world record. Fast forward almost 40 years and the star, part of Keeping Up with the Kardashians reality TV extravaganza as husband of Kris Kardashian, revealed that they'd separated and subsequently was transitioning to become Caitlyn. This was not some sudden decision. Caitlyn had known since her teenage years that she'd wanted to be a woman, but there were 3 marriages and 10 children and stepchildren along the way. In 2015, she went public with her new life in a spectacularly glamorous way. And in January this year, she completed her sex reassignment surgery. Now in her new book, The Secrets of My Life, she's told the story of her long and difficult journey from Bruce to Caitlyn. I met her earlier. At the heart of this book, I think there's an overwhelming sadness in a way that, in a sense, you've had to live so much of your life outwardly to the world as everything's fine, and yet there's been this incredible subterfuge so that actually you can have all the adulation outside, but what actually matters to you is 20 minutes in a Marriott hotel or wherever, where you can secretly be who you are.
Yeah, who you are. That was a constant struggle. And even after the games, many years ago, I remember the next morning getting up and looking in the mirror and putting a gold medal around my neck and, you know, didn't have a stitch of clothes on. And I'm looking at the mirror and I said, oh my God, did I build up such a character here that I'm stuck with him for the rest of my life? You know, because it doesn't represent, that's not me. It's not who I am.
You talk about a moment where you were about to have an operation to reduce your Adam's apple and it got out. I think it might have been TMZ, I'm not sure.
TMZ,
TMZ. And
good
at that point,
Harvey Levin. Yes.
You felt very low. And I wonder, did you actually feel suicidal?
I was home, walking up and down at 3 o'clock in the morning, walking up and down the hallway in my little house and knowing that this is probably going to come out tomorrow. And honestly, at that point, I didn't really want to deal with it because I knew the paparazzis would be going crazy on me. The stories would be off the wall. And, you know, I thought, that, yeah, you know what? The easy thing is to go in the other room You know, hey, just end it right here. End the story. It's been a great life. You know, end the story right here, and then I don't have to deal with all this crap. And, you know, obviously I didn't. But that was one of, that and my conversation with God were kind of the turning points. Where the next day I thought, wasn't that stupid thinking about something like that?
Gemma Ingrier put her foot back into this controversy. She'd been in it before, but she put her foot into this controversy last year on Australian television. We said, she's actually talking about you. I don't believe that a man who has lived for 40 years as a man and has had children, it's not fair for the man to decide that he is a woman.
I can see that, and I respect that opinion, and you're absolutely right. I will never bear children. I have a lot of children, but I wasn't on the other end, okay? But that doesn't make me any less of who I was. It's like this woman living inside me has been there all my life. It's time to let her live. It's time to give her a chance. To be honest with you, Bruce did about everything Bruce could do.
You are a Republican.
Oh, God, yes. Honestly, that was more difficult to come out as Republican than it was as trans.
Okay.
Yes.
Well, you're also a supporter of Donald Trump. And at first, he said, he did during the campaign, support the idea that LGBTQ people could use, for example, the restrooms that they wished. And that now has been rescinded. He's turned turtle on that. What do you think about that? Is that the kind of thing that you should be campaigning on?
I do campaign on it. I'm all over all that stuff. There is a political side to this, obviously. I did talk to Trump. First of all, people say, oh, you're a supporter of Donald Trump. No, I am. I like the Republican Party because I believe in limited government, and I believe in the people of this country, not the government. If we're going to get out of all these messes we're in, it's going to be the people that are going to do it, not government. And Trump was our candidate. So obviously, I'm going to vote for him. And I did. I thought he would be pretty good when it comes to LGBTQ issues. I talked to him during the campaign. And he put down some federal guidelines, which I think is important when it comes to dealing with LGBT issues and trans issues. And he rescinded that, and it just really ticked me off. I mean, I did tweeting about it. I went public about it.
But have you had any response from him at all?
No. He wants me to go play golf with him, but unfortunately when he did that, I can't because I would be destroyed by my community.
But isn't that the best way to get to him on the golf course?
I totally agree. From my standpoint, I would spend 4 hours with him and say, hey, what the hell are you doing?
Well, do it.
I would rather do it now privately.
And you will?
Oh, and I will. I guarantee you I will.
Outwardly, you are different. Inwardly, do you allow yourself to feel different, or is it just the way you've always been? You talk about having the soul of a woman.
Mm-hmm.
Have you changed in any way, do you think?
I think I've changed a lot. I've been able to see the world from the other side. I lived for 65 years as old Bruce. It takes a while, time, and I'm 2 years in, to kind of leave Bruce behind because he's still in there, okay?
Do you think there's a more nurturing side of you you're allowed to come out now, or have you always been a nurturer?
I've always had a nurturing side to me, but definitely it has come out more now. I have 10 children, okay? I have my 11th grandchild the other day. You know what's kind of cool about the grandchildren? They only know Caitlin. Mm-hmm. My relationships with all of my family, very close friends, in most cases has gotten better. Mm-hmm. I don't have all of the turmoil inside of me. I'm just free to be myself.
Caitlin Jenner, thank you very much indeed. Before we go, Britain's oldest swimming pool, Victoria Baths in Manchester, will be open for swimming for the first time in 24 years this Sunday. The 101-year-old bath fell into disrepair in the 1990s, but after winning the BBC's restoration competition in 2003, they're slowly on the way back to life. They'll open for one day only, but organisers hope the money raised from the event will allow them to complete the restoration. Here's a look at Manchester's so-called Water Palace, then and now. Good night.